what they're called. Okay. So today we're talking about ways that traditional knowledge could be used to increase the resilience of tribal communities to climate change, and it's a very important and sacred topic. So that's why we're doing it in a circle, because we realize the value of this discussion topic. And so we want to honor that in this inclusive way that is part of our community. So thank you for joining us here. And the format is that we're going to give 10 minutes to each of the panelists to talk about this topic, with the key questions about how are traditional values implemented in ag practices, farming, ranching, and forest management, and how do these values enhance resiliency in your community, and can these be transferred to other communities, and if so, how? So we'll actually just go down the line here so that we can make it more smooth. So I'll let here start.
Okay. So hello, everybody. I'm really glad to be here today. Did a little thinking on these questions. I feel like they're really important, and I'm grateful that this conference is holding space for topics along these lines to be discussed, and you know, it's an honor to be on a panel with you all here today. So I'm just going to kind of drill down through the questions, because they provide a really neat framing, I think. So I'll give a little bit of background into the work that I've been doing that kind of brought me here today. So my tribe is in northeastern Oklahoma, and there's only a few of us that are still growing our traditional foods. And, so we've started to kind of coordinate an interstate effort to preserve, starting with corn, our different sacred colors of corn. And we got down in the 1970s to about two handfuls of our corn. So that's basically extinction. There's been a few growers that have kind of kept things going since that time that we very much pay respect to, and then a new generation of us that are trying to keep that going. Our efforts are coordinated with a national effort called Braiding the Sacred, which is a group of indigenous seed carriers, traditional corn growers, from Canada down to Mexico. We have solidarity networks between Canada and South America. And so our intention behind that work is to really provide an indigenous response to a monoculture mindset. This idea that our ways and traditions are absolutely wrapped in and inherent in the approaches that we take to agriculture. When we look at this word management, even, that word can be considered a power dynamic word that, you know, is inherent within a colonial construct. I've gotten wrapped on the hand, so to speak, for using that word around an elder before, who said it's not about management, it's about fulfilling your responsibilities traditionally. This idea of our values, our traditional values, and our life ways permeate through every level of what we do traditionally. So they're interconnected, and they're not separated. They can't be compartmentalized in that regard. So I think that's a huge point that I've learned in my young life. I'm still trying to work on and grapple with and implement when close to the land, when growing traditional foods, for example, especially the corn, which is so close to my heart. you know, restoration work is kind of like an acknowledgement of that sacred connection. For a lot of folks, though, it hasn't really gone away, so restoration is even a word that, you know, can be problematic. You know, English, when we use it within these contexts, is really just talking between aisles. A lot of our old people would talk about how, you know, our words, our language, you know, frames what we do within a different construct than how we would communicate it in English. But braiding the sacred, this network that I'm really appreciative to be a part of traditional corn growers throughout the country, is really looking at how corn can be a unifier of tribes, again, north and south. And of course, there's all sorts of nations that, you know, don't have corn as central to their creation stories or, you know, within their life ways. But there's a whole string of us from Canada down to South America that can unify around that. And it's a real healing to come together around a particular food way. And, you know, gratitude for the gift that has been provided to us by our Creator, and framing things from that mindset is really kind of a starting point for, you know, those of us young folks that are kind of doing this work. And, you know, we can't really, again, separate it into a one-size-fits-all type of situation. We each have our stories attached to our traditional foods and ways in which we tend for the land so that we can, in fact, receive the bounty and participate in that beautiful creation there. So transitioning to the second question there, how do traditional values affect cultural, agricultural, or ecological resiliency? Resiliency is in the interactive relationship. So that's another word I want to bring forward. There's a relationship inherent in this, in working within traditional food ways. One thing that I talk a lot about is how beautiful, how absolutely beautiful and sacred it is to work with traditional foods, to work with something that built our ancestors' bones, and how deep that is, and that the effort that it takes to get out there and pray, you know, early, to get out there and work with the land, to get out there and, you know, tend to a particular area for growing, and then sharing in that bounty, like that's in a completely different ballpark of blessing than, you know, going to some McDonald's on the corner. It's an absolute gift to those of us that do that work, that are taking on that sacred responsibility to share. And, you know, our Osage cooks, especially from my clan, cook with a good mind. And that's what a lot of tribal communities I know can relate to that. But cook with a good mind, with that idea that what they're doing is ushering in a healing from the Creator through them, through their channeling of that effort with a good mind, a clean way, and the appropriate protocols attached to, you know, preparing food. They're being a vehicle, a channel for the ingestion of a healing of their friends and family and relatives. So that act is, again, so much about responsibility and a fulfillment of responsibility, the maintenance of a relationship there. You know, I looked up the word arid, and I want to make sure I'm keeping an eye on the time, because I got about four minutes or so. I looked up the word arid, you know, just to kind of root me in what I'd be walking into. This is my first one of these gatherings here. And a secondary definition was really interesting to me. It lacking interest lacking excitement or meaning. So that's a secondary definition of this term, so native waters on arid lands. And again, like, I want to think about that idea of relationship, that, you know, as native peoples, place is so critical. Place is what our creation stories are inherently, you know, rooted in. And again, if we don't have our young people involved in, you know, their hands in the earth, their hands in the tending of life, because that's what working with our traditional foods is about, through my understanding and perspective, being life tenders, right? So if we don't have those connections that we're bestowing upon and helping to provide model around for our up-and-coming generations, and listening to our elders, and listening to their stories, and learning more about our ways, you know, then, you know, that land that, you know, is of our communities that we're built out of, may begin to take on some of that secondary definition of arid. And that's a scary place to be in this day and age, especially when connection has been severed in so many ways, and that there's a systematic attempt at doing that, that severing through modernity, and trying to weave and dodge through all that. That last question here, are traditional values transferable among communities? And if so, what can native waters on arid lands do to facilitate these exchanges? One of the things that I was thinking about was through that, you know, mindset of our native communities. And this is not an assumption that I would want to lead with. However, when we get together within our native communities and intertribal gatherings, this is what emerges, is the unity, and is the recognition, and is the desire to connect around storytelling. And so I think that the identification and the transfer is not something that can be constructed, but is something that when the stage is set, it emerges out of our connections. And so, for this gathering, and you know, I think a big thing that I would want to contribute would be the idea to begin working with tribal communities and having nations host these gatherings out on their lands. So then there's something really deep and powerful that comes from native peoples being visitors to other communities and working to just feel into those lands and the ancestry that is absolutely present, you know, in that environment. And so, you know, that's been happening for eons, and ought to happen with gatherings like this, where, you know, we leave the casino ballrooms and we go into our native communities that are interested in hosting something like this to help to support a response mechanism to that potential for that secondary definition of arid, you know, where we lose that connection to those places and practices and protocols associated with their land. They're alive and well in a lot of communities, and unfortunately they're being lost in others. And that's what I have to share. Thank you all for listening.
So my name is Anna Eichner, and I've been with Nourishing Systems for about a year now. And one of the things that I'm doing there is attempting to document there's so much dryness, and there's so much marijuana. So you have all these different kinds of land issues, and the legislators seem to be really confused about this marijuana thing, and the marijuana is using a lot of the water. So what I'm attempting to do is document Scott's indigenous practices, and in the process learn to be a better teacher. So my approach is that you can do something for gardening any time of the year. You can work on the soil, you can plant, you can harvest, you can preserve, and in between each of those other things, you can plant cover crops in the winter or the spring. You can compost the trenches like most of you saw this morning, and take those messages out that there are ways to save water and make your soil richer and happier in the process. In terms of what native waters can do is, we would really love to go to some genuinely dry areas and set up these trench techniques and see how they work and attempt to set up like 50 by 50 plots and watch things grow. It's just so fun. So that's all I have.
Hi, my name is George Toya. I'm from Jemez Pueblo. I run the farming program for Nambia Pueblo. I grew up farming. I was born in the 50s, you know, and when I grew up with my grandparents and my parents next door to each other, and my grandparents were my babysitters when I was growing up, and every day I went to the field with my grandparents, and we went on horseback or either in his wagon with the horses, because he never had a car, and most of the guys I grew up with are the children that were my age. We all grew up the same way. None of our elders spoke English, so native language was what we heard every day. And then we would go to the fields and plant and tend to the crops and irrigate. And it was a good way to grow up, because we were exposed to a way of life that is no longer practiced, you know. And so with that, you absorb all this knowledge of and ways to do things, because that's all you did, you know. And so that applies to most of the things I do now. And my grandfather was my main babysitter, and he would take me to all the fields. And he died when I was 14, and he was 98 years old. So I didn't realize he was 84 years old when he was taking me, you know, in his 80s, when he was hauling me around on a horse and wagon and stuff. And you know, and most of the kids I grew up with were kind of raised that way too, with, you know, all these old people, and so you know, as we got older, got kind of a American education, went through the whole schooling system, and I worked in engineering for a number of years, and decided I didn't want to do that anymore, so started a business and was successful at that for over 20 years, and I retired from that, and then I went back to farming, you know. And so the farming program in Nambe Pueblo is kind of based on how we were raised at that time. Nothing was sold, everything was given or traded, and so that's how we run our system now. We don't sell anything that we grow. We distribute it to the community members. We sustain ourselves through grants and other means, anything that we can find, and we share everything that we do. And it's a really nice system, because many of the elder folks in Nambe Pueblo can relate to that, because that's how they grew up also. Most of the Pueblo tribes, and I guess most of the tribes in the Southwest, had the same type of system, and it's to carry on those way of life is kind of really hard to do because, you know, of all the outside influences on the youth, but to expose them to something like that is very good because it gives them a different perspective also. You know, everything now, many things now is not based on sharing anymore, and it's good to have the youth exposed to that type of environment where you don't ask for anything in return, you just give. And so it's been a real challenge, but it's been really a good thing to do because, you know, people always expect something in return, you know, when you do something. But when you don't ask for anything in return, then it kind of puzzles them, you know, and this is, why are you doing this? You're not really benefiting, but in different ways you are. So when we started our farming program, we tried to focus mostly on the plants and the crops that were always grown in the area. And so what we did was we went throughout the community and asked a lot of the elders if they had seeds that they had. And the majority of them had seeds that they had they're all heirloom varieties that they had saved and their parents had grown and, you know, all the way down the line. So that's what we collected and made a seed bank of all these different crops. And we started planting them and harvesting and saving some more. And so now we have a system where we can share the seeds and we don't ask for anything in return, but just to give us seeds when they grow their crops so that we can keep replenishing our seed banks. And same way with the cattle and the forestry, you know, everything was done with prayer, you know, in our way, you know, get up early in the morning to greet the sun and late at night, you know, you greet the darkness and so, you know, and it creates a really nice cycle. And it teaches you to that there's other things greater than yourself and there's, you know, you're an insignificant part of the whole picture. And so when we do this, you know, we ask a lot of the older folks to participate and help us out and interact with the youth, because, you know, it only takes one generation to lose a culture, you know, and if you don't carry it on, it's going to be lost or it's going to be watered down, you know. So that's kind of like really our focus on why we're doing this type of thing. Language preservation. What we do is we got all these different phrases in Tewa language, and made signs for everything. You know, every plant, every weed, rock, implement. So we made all these signs and put the corresponding English word with it, you know, so that to remind the kids and all the, even the adults, that when they walk by, you know, they can see what if they don't know the word, it's right there, you know. So, and then in the arbor we have like phrases like for a sunny day, a rainy day, that was windy, and all these other things, you know, and it's really fun to see, even though the adults come up and take a look at it and they say, oh yeah, that's what that means, you know, or that's how you say it. And then, or sometimes they come and ask you, how do you say this, you know? So it's the kids are the ones that absorb this more, you know, they know all this stuff and they see it all the time. And it's really preservation, you know, it's us saving ourselves, you know. And so anyways, you know, it's, to go back to the management, it's not really management, it's existing with it, you know. Because, you know, we tend to think of ourselves as above everything, and we're in charge of everything, but we're not. You know, we're just coexisting with everything else, and that's one of the main lessons that that we need to realize, and that we're just part of the earth, you know, and we can't think of ourselves as above or, you know, or in control of everything. And so, so that's how we maintain our resiliency, and then to how the knowledge is transferred is by example. We've always learned by example. You know, 100 years ago, you know, most of our tribal members didn't know how to read and write, and so everything they learned was by example. There was a lot of good teachers back then too, and there was a lot of really knowledgeable people, because they have to retain everything in their head, you know, they have to remember. And right now, that's why a lot of languages are being lost, because people don't train their minds to remember like that. They rely on a little piece of electronics that is their memory for them. That's why, you know, that's why it's so hard for a lot of the youth to engage with the older people, because they don't know how to do that anymore. They don't have that memory anymore, and so that's one of the things that we're working on, and that's one of the goals of our program, is to engage everybody. And so we have a really good group of people in our farming program, and it's a mixture of elder and youth working together to run this program, and it's really good to see that it's possible to bring back a lot of the traditional values and morals and the culture. Because you mix older and younger people together, and you come up with something, you know, unique. And so, anyways, that's what we do, and that's what we're going to try to continue doing. And it's happening a lot throughout Native country, all over. You know, there's everybody's trying to be more sustainable and more sovereign. You know, but I heard a good phrase, you know, at one of these conferences I went to. It's, you know, you can't be truly sovereign until you can provide for your own people. And so, and you know, that includes not just, you know, food and stuff like that, but that also includes the mind, you know, the way you think and the way you address things within your own community, and remembering the past is a good thing, because that's where you came from, you know. And so anyways, that's pretty much what I had to say. Thank you
Mr. Tokoya. I want to take a moment and just ask everybody, you pals, to open the circle so we can invite the others here. We're talking in a circle.
My last service was in Oregon.
So
where did you sit?
Here.
Oh, really?
No. Are you from here?
It wasn't.
Oh, you weren't?
My name is Scott Good. My
father's side of the family is where I come by my indigenous tradition. But my grandmother was one of the non-res Cheyenne people. Anything that had to do with the government, she completely mistrusted. And so she considered the reservation system as complicity with the federal government. My grandfather's heritage was mixed blood between indigenous people, not even getting to who they were, and the Sephardic Jews that were driven out of Europe and settled in northern New Mexico and southern Colorado. And both of those groups were outrunning the same people, staying away from the same people, because the Sephardic Jews had to be completely silent about their heritage and blend in high. And the indigenous people were the only ones that would accept that heritage. And it was useful because Sephardic Jews knew a little bit about Europeans and some of their ways, and that became useful. So that's how I come by my heritage. My grandparents lived as far away from any city or town as they possibly could, because they felt the influences of that were bad for their souls. So as a result, they kept many, particularly of the agricultural traditions, and they handed those traditions on to me. And those traditions were a little less about the crops themselves, but the way that the land was cultivated, the love that was put into that, the observations, minute observations about climate and how this year was progressing as far as the weather was concerned. And keeping, even though they didn't know the scientific details of it, their understanding about the way soil biology and soil physics worked, without knowing any of the science or words for that, but their understanding was absolutely profound. So when I went off and studied soils, you know, I remember sitting in soils physics class going, how did they know that? You know, how did they, but they just knew it, you know, down in their bones. They understood how this worked. So I was very fortunate that I spent a good part of my youth, because my family moved to a place that I didn't want to be, and I loved my grandparents and what they taught me. So I was able to absorb very, very deeply and richly that tradition. And similar to your story, I became an environmental engineer and got away from that. But in that entire perspective, the whole focus of my life's work at that time was in healing the land from the devastation that I saw happening all around me. And one of the roles that I have now is I teach soils courses and small farming courses. And basically what I'm doing is transmitting the techniques and the understanding that I learned from my grandparents to young farmers that have just been, you know, the extension service, small farming and soils classes. And so right next to the tractor-based small farms program in Southern Oregon at the Extension Service, we have another farming plot where we're teaching these old techniques, and it's called the Food Security Garden. And there's two facets of security. One thing is exclusively grow food for the food banks in our community. And this concept that we feed those that are most in need first, because, you know, we can take care of ourselves, but feeding that community. But the other part of food security is, you know, in Oregon, we're always thinking about the Cascadian Fault when it wipes out I-5 and there's no fuel trucks or fertilizer trucks coming in. Are there going to be enough people that can feed that area in under those circumstances. And that's really what the food security garden is based on, teaching techniques that require no outside influence, that are completely carried out by hand using techniques that are so subtle, but they're really more art than they are work. So that's the perspective that I come to agriculture. And as it turns out, right now there's this big change in agriculture moving into no-till, building the biology in the soil, because we're destroying the soil by our current techniques of agriculture. And one of the sides of this is there's research being done, I mentioned earlier, in New Mexico, New Mexico State University. It's demonstrating when you do agriculture with these techniques, your crop productivity goes up, soil moisture increases, soil biology increases, but most importantly, you sequester an enormous amount of carbon dioxide when you don't plow. And you have this biology constantly taking the carbon dioxide of the air and turning it into organic rich soil. And as I mentioned earlier, it's been demonstrated that if you practice these agricultural techniques on as little as 12% of the arable land on the planet, you can reverse the carbon dioxide facet of greenhouse gases. And 12%, that's not a lot. In all likelihood, if you went to every organic farmer growing food for farmer's market and got them to use this technique, you'd make a huge impact just by that activity. No national programs, no international accords, just farmers farming. It'd have a huge impact. And so that's where I feel that this indigenous wisdom, if put into the hands of, you know, be wonderful if all of the tribal lands were practicing this. But one of the problems when the Mayflower came over is that no one on the Mayflower recognized the wisdom and traditions that were there. And I feel like that if they had been, their eyes opened and understood, the devastation of that culture on this land would never have happened. If they had been able to respect the land, learn that from the people that were here, realize it, that that's what they had lost, and why their continent was filled with war. And so allowing this understanding to filter out into the broader culture, I think is an important part of being indigenous, is opening people's eyes to indigenosity, the relationship with the land, where you realize the sacredness of what you're doing. And that's the only way I think people will retreat from the savagery and destruction that industrial farming and all of the other facets of this industrial culture. It's the only way it's going to stop. So, you know, implementing these traditions even outside the tribal context, I think, is an important thing. It's something that we can bring to the world that it is lost and desperately needs. So that's kind of the perspective that I take from indigenous traditions. Because these practices could dramatically change what's happening in our climate. It's interesting, one of the climate analyses of the level of carbon dioxide and warming has modeled suggests that at the time when indigenous people on this continent used to control vegetation by fire and care, that when that tradition stopped, that there was a noticeable increase in carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, not because of industrialization. I mean, that was an important characteristic. But before industrialization really got ramped up, that this change in the way human beings were engaged in the earth, that you could actually see a change in the climate associated with that as well. I think that that's, you know, an important perspective that, that we can bring to the world and change things around.
For the presenter from the Osage tribe, I was wondering that.
Yeah.
In your talk about preparing food and cooking and all of those concepts about your traditional perspective on preparing those foods in a way that's going to provide nourishment and sustenance to your people, do you also have that sort of respect for wildlife when you hunt and capture or kill wildlife to feed the people in your family? Do you have those same perspectives?
Oh, absolutely. On our land, we had a fairly large... I misunderstood.
Absolutely. Yeah, and that's, it's again that idea that we're dealing in the realm of the sacred when taking a life, and you know, our plants are live, you know, lives too, you know, so and for the nourishment of our people, right? That's fulfilling a responsibility there, but it's also participating in the acknowledgement of that that realm of our original instructions around what the Creator provided to us. So in our creation stories, we have corn, the same colored squash, and the same colored animal that were given to us. And we have these different colors of each of these varieties. And so that's in our instructions. So we're dealing in that depth and absolutely have to be in the acknowledgement of the realm that we're in traditionally.
Thank you, Scott. I'd like to move on to Laurel. We'll come back and take discussion.
So I'm approaching this question about the traditional values implemented in forest management from my personal background, not from a tribal perspective, but from my experiences. I'm Yakima from Eastern Washington State and have lived and worked there, you know, majority of my life. And I guess my interdisciplinary background, began with, wildland firefighting. And being out there, in those lands, learning about that as well as the fire component, and then moving on into wildlife management. And as a part of the wildlife program there at Yakima, I worked on endangered species in relation to forest management for about 10 years. And then beyond that, an additional nearly 10 years working on wildlife species in general, wildlife impacts for timber sales. And so I've heard a lot of things today, that I think are also important when considering forest management activities and how that relates to traditional ecological knowledge and resiliency. I think you have to approach it from the standpoint of, that word resiliency. Is that management or is that a response to management? It's like most times up there in the Pacific Northwest, my tribe, we dealt with the spruce budworm, for over 10 years, 14 plus years. And that's a response, that's not management. We're responding to this, epidemic of this, forest pest. When you look at other things that occur out there on the landscape, whether it be, wildland fires, those are something that you're responding to, until recently, I think, and I'm talking decades, you didn't see tribes implementing fire on their landscape as much. And a lot of that has to do with some of the fire policies in the United States. And, when tribes, especially the timber tribes, started to assert their own jurisdiction over their lands and started implementing fire back on their landscape. Before that,
when you look at the federal role and the federal policies that led to, you know, that fire exclusion, you have long periods of fire exclusion in this country because, you know, fires destroyed so many lands. And tribes at that point in time, they didn't have, you know, the trained individuals. They were being managed by, you know, BIA, and how many of those initial BIA, you know, foresters and firefighting, you know, personnel were actually tribal members. And so I think if you look at it, you know, from a decadal standpoint, tribes are just now beginning to reassert not only their traditional knowledge, you know, but that in combination with, you know, their jurisdiction over their lands by implementing some of these policies that allow for fire to be put back on the land. Management activities that are outside the norm for maybe the region that they're in, you know, the way they manage. I spent 10 years working solely on endangered species for the Yakama Nation, and then another 10 years looking at timber sales and how timber sales affect all the wildlife species. But that also included all the plants. You know, I didn't focus entirely on, you know, the forest for that. You know, it came down into, you know, our agricultural area. The Yakima Valley is a huge agricultural area for the Washington State, actually for the Pacific Northwest. And, you know, some of those things that are happening down in the valley, you know, are being influenced by what's happening up in the mountains and the headwaters or some of the streams and rivers and everything. So when you start looking at planning for, you know, a single timber sale or for a watershed, you know, I think one thing that the tribes have going for them that I don't know is paid attention to as well as tribes do in state agencies and federal agencies is the level of interdisciplinary team planning. You know, I'll be the first to say, you know, the 10 years I had to work on an interdisciplinary team, you know, I didn't always enjoy it. I didn't always recognize in that moment the value of the education that I was receiving in understanding that type of a planning mechanism for a large forest. And I'll preface that by saying, but Yakima Nation, you know, we have 1.3 million acres of land in Washington State. Of that, we have about 450,000 acres of forested lands. And, you know, there's a lot of different management schemes within that, you know, 400 plus, you know, 1,000 acres, you know, where we have, you know, riparian and primitive and game reserves and winter wildlife habitat, you know, and then we have the administrative forest. You know, that doesn't include our woodlands. You know, we do not have the personnel to really address the woodlands that are present on our landscape, even still today. I mean, when I worked on timber sales for wildlife, I was the only person that worked on timber sales for wildlife for at least 8 years. And so there was years where, especially at the height of our spruce bedroom epidemic, you know, I had 8 or 9 timber sales going at the same time that I had to address issues on. And so, you know, I think it was a great learning environment for me to understand all the different needs that needed to be balanced. I was also, at that time, really the only one that had gone through a lot of federal policy training. I did a year-long program at the University of Washington for environmental law and regulations, and so I became like a NEPA person for my tribe, and that pulled me out of the forest to address a lot of other issues. But the thing, again, is the type of planning was always the same, interdisciplinary. You know, you sat in the room and you talked to folks from, you know, fisheries and, you know, as well as me from wildlife, but, you know, maybe, you know, all different aspects of forestry, our cultural resources, our elders, you know, everybody is involved in that level of planning, trying to figure out how we could fulfill the mission statement of the Yakama Nation, which is to preserve, protect, and enhance for future generations. You know, and when you're told, you know, this is your mission, this is how you have to consider every single action that you take on the landscape. You know, you realize, you know, the weight of your activity, whether it's signing off on one document or you know, actually being out there on the ground as you're, you know, helping the foresters mark trees and decide what's going to be harvested, and how that's influencing maybe, you know, the non-timber, you know, forest resources that are out there, all of our foods and our medicines that we also collect. I mean, we have a lot of berries, we have a lot of roots that, you know, we harvest every year on our lands there at Yakima. I've been living in Montana working on, you know, my PhD, but I've still been going home to Yakima, and, you know, I go root digging, I go pick berries, I gather medicines. You know, those are things that are still important. Another aspect of resiliency, though, with all of that as a background now, I think is in looking at this day and age, you know, for our generations, is we have to look at how we are doing things compared to how things were done, you know, 30, 40, 50 years ago. And how is that impacting those resources that we still have to manage today? And when I say that, I'm thinking of on that forested landscape. If you, I'll give an example from my tribe and from what I learned growing up in talking to my grandfather and my parents. You know, we have lands where we harvest huckleberries, and it's up near Mount Adams, you know, kind of at the base of the Mount Adams area is where our huckleberry fields start. And you start, you know, moving down in elevation from that. And as I grew up, I learned about how, you know, my mom, my uncles, you know, my aunts, my grandparents, my great-grandparents, you know, there were certain times of year when they would go up to these higher elevations and they would be camping. But you think about how they got there. You know, they didn't drive up with their RV camper and everything, you know, like you're able to do nowadays. You know, and back then there was a lot more tribal members that had cattle and horses, you know, and that was their mode of transportation. And so you think about the numbers, you know, the demographics of what was present on the land during that time, how many tribal members, and so how many of those types of activities to how things took place, you know, decades and decades ago. It's completely different. And so in trying to hang on to that and understand that traditional knowledge, you really have to try to understand how were things done, you know, back in those early days? How were they preserved? How were they enhanced? What did they do to try to protect them from season to season? Because the typical logging activities that take place, you know, that's not capturing it. You know, and then when you start getting into the epidemic situations, you know, with some of our forest pests, you know, that's definitely creating a whole different environment than you would have seen, you know, 50 years ago, 60 years ago, you know, where you've got hundreds, you know, of acres, you know, thousands of acres being impacted by one forest pest. And so I've looked at that question of traditional knowledge from that standpoint. And a lot of this is because the PhD work that I'm doing right now is looking at a forest history.
Okay, I want to leave time for discussion, so let's keep moving along. Thank you, Laurel.
I just want to say thank you for the opportunity to participate. Thank you to all the presenters so far. I really enjoyed your presentations and your take on different things. My name is Neil Morton, as I said before. I'm the chairman of the Washoe Tribe of Nevada, California. I've been in office currently for 3 years, been elected at large by the members of our tribe. Tribal history is we range from Honey Lake, which is about maybe an hour and a half north of here, all the way down to Mono Lake, which is probably 2.5 hours from here. As you travel north and south, center of the Washoe's world and universe is Lake Tahoe, Talladega, which is just over the mountain there, the eastern Sierras here, or the eastern Pinot Range. Traditional homeland of the Washoe, manage two types of forests, pine forests, as well as the traditional forest or the big timber forest up in here. The Comstock impacted our people at the turn of the century. Much damage was done, clear cutting to the basin, to the pine range. So it's a sensitive topic to many of our peoples, to many of our families. Impact when you look at ecological knowledge that is in some areas lost when it relates to knowledge of crops and growing seasons. The Washoe people weren't farmers. They were hunters, and they were gatherers, and they traveled lightly. They respected the land as much as what you said. Management is not a word that's involved in the language. It's, you know, a balance between each person and their environment. And it's important that each person knows that. I've heard a lot of talk at this summit and other places that I've gone and spoken on behalf as the chairman about creator, and more importantly, as creation, how do we interact in that, some people would say divine relationship, some might say as a created being, some might say in other ways, in other tribes and other cultures, how do you interact on that level? And you teach that to your family, and how do you interact on that level as a father and a mother? Part of the Washoe culture that is most important and nearest to me is family. Family is a key component of what matters. Everything around us does better if our family unit is strong. Much of what you've described here, family units have been under attack for a long time. So it's important to remember that. Ecological knowledge, you know, to the Washoe people, were forced through boarding school assimilation initially. It ended up being something in the end that elders that I've spoken to, it didn't end up being such a bad thing going to boarding school and getting an education and doing certain things, but initially it wasn't a good thing. So some of the cultural practices and traditions have been gone. Part of the reason I believe I'm here is because I've spoken up at the lake. You know, I feel fortunate as the chairman that we have an opportunity in the basin more recently to speak and be part of some of the things. And what I've come to understand is with science, many people's lives and careers are tied up into their studies and into what they've done, and they call it their legacy, which is no disrespect intended for those who practice those and their legacies leave behind. But in one change, in one season, in one day, in one month, the devastation of a catastrophic wildfire, anything can change. And yet some of these practices are still attempted to be implemented on the landscape. And how do you get that across? I've expressed that to many state agencies here in the local area in an attempt to try to work with them, not to take away from the work that they put together, which all ties back into this ecological knowledge. Because the society as we know it has changed, it's diversified, as many people will say. It will never be what it once was, at least not to our families. But how do you tie in and implement and be successful, more importantly, back to your family unit, and respect for your family, and respect for the land, and respect for what you teach your children and your grandchildren? It's a balance. It's a balance that I would say probably nobody in this room is going to be a master of, but yet most of us, I would hope, have enough respect for ourselves and our own families to look for that balance, to work for that balance, and to be part of, you know, one of our council members always says, what are the solutions? Many people focus on studying what the options are, and what the reality of this instance is, you know, but what are some of the solutions? You know, I hear that every time I think about something as a chairman, and people will tell me, well, you're young. We don't expect to see someone like you holding that title. Well, there was enough people that thought they wanted to afford me the opportunity. So here, once again, I bring that knowledge. And, you know, as in all things, as a leader, you know, you never carry the voice of all your people, but you always want to respect all of your membership and their right to have different opinions and different thought processes and for them to be successful in what they do. So the ecological knowledge, you know, a lot of our people ended up in those schools, the Stuart Indian School, which is right down the street from here, and they ended up doing well in farming and ranching and, you know, cattlemen. Our tribe operates about 3,000 acres of ranch here, it's about an hour from here, south. The Stuart Ranch, which was associated with the Stuart Indian Boarding School, that ended up coming back to the tribe in the late 80s, you know, through congressional action. The tribe also received back, as it's referred to on the plaque on the side of the highway, that one of the original ranch families felt it good to give the Washoe people some land. Essentially, it was returned 800 acres in that one particular instance. So how do you balance all that with it? You know, many of that with our elders, it's near and dear to them. They feel strongly about that ranch. To this day, they're still interested in how the cattle ranch operation's going. How is crop management going? You know, why isn't the alfalfa fields being taken care of properly? Where are the irrigation? How are we protecting our irrigation rights? In Nevada, it's a whole other ballgame than in some other areas. Some of those water rights that our tribe has only comes through, you know, the Alpine Decree, which ends up being something, you know, back in the day where people fought and lived and died and killed for cattle and water, all those different things, you know, and some of the returned properties to the tribe ended up having some of those water rights. Some not as senior and some are, you know, more junior along that line, you know, and how do you balance that with the influx of, you know, not so traditional knowledge and the youth and the young people in our tribe that want to do other things, living in this urban area, in the Reno area, in the Carson area, you know, with the influx of drugs and alcohol and everything that, you know, most people don't talk about. What we know as tribal families is damaged so much. How do you incorporate all that knowledge back into your young generations and your young people? It's as much of a question as is it a statement. because that's what so much of what we do and what we face as tribal leaders, as tribal people. You know, it's always refreshing to me, and I'm not that old, but I'm also not as young as some of the people I've seen, to see the interest in the sciences and to see the interest in the environment. Because what is the key component about the environment? Everything seems to live in harmony, minus us. Some of us do a better job of trying to fit in with the environment than others do. You know, there's always a big push for balance. You know, one side's fighting against the other to try to restore balance into the system that has been out of whack, as you said, for how long? How far can you go back? I mean, it depends on where you're from, where your roots are at, and where you are, and who you are, and where your family originated from. How do you restore that, knowing we all occupy the same time and space? It's one of those things you balance. You know, I have a great immense amount of respect for, you know, the panelists here. You know, I have known good Indians all over the country, and more closely here to the Western United States. And you hear about the history of different tribes, and termination, and different things that have happened. Two tribes. And where do you find those balances at? Starting today and going through tomorrow and balancing it out? How do you represent your people and your family every day along the lines of the questions that you have here? You know, I've summed up a couple of them in regards to the fact that, you know, how do traditional values are implemented in agricultural practices, farming, ranches, and forest management? The Washoe people would introduce fire into the rangeland as they left one system into another system with their families as they travel through back and forth. Can that practice be done today? You've said it's been successful in some of your areas. The Washoe people don't have that influence in the area that they once inhabited to be able to be part of that conversation. That's one of the reasons I'm sitting here, because I just, you know, I feel strongly that those balances have got to be tried to be put back into place for all of our benefit. Most people, you know, will call it a tribal consultation when they deal with a tribal official on a government-to-government consultation, but any of you that ever participated in that, somewhat similar to dealing with the scientists that represent these federal and state agencies, they only listen as far as they want to hear. You're there many times for lip service, and yet I keep speaking anyway, regardless of if it's heard, because I feel that strongly about it. So yeah, there's a place for that. I believe more people begin to listen, and you know, the sciences will tell you one thing, and the sciences will tell you another thing, and they continually change from what I've seen in the time that I've been there. But one thing that's remained consistent, in my opinion, is our people and our families, through change, through implementation of all these different scientific procedures and methods and methodology, our families have still remained. That's one thing that I've seen that has been consistent. So with that, how do you tie that back into your ecological knowledge? How traditional values affect cultural, agriculture, and ecological resiliency, like I spoke to you earlier about the health of your family. How healthy is your family and your families, and how do they interact with the ecosystem and everything that they do and everything that we do? How well does that tie into what we're doing? It's different for everybody. It's different for all tribes. It's different for the members of our tribe, and you know, the way we function, the transference or exchange of traditional values among tribal communities. You know, some of the elders will tell us, if you found a lady from another tribe, you would marry her, you'd bring her in, and she would assimilate to your people. And if your ladies would leave and go and assimilate to another tribe, they would go and they would stay there. But through that practice, how would that happen? Our tribe has a history going back over 10,000 years identified archaeologically in this area. That's something most tribes can't boast about. There's a site right down the street from here that I've been made aware of, where they have the 7,000 years they've dug down to the Mazama ash layer, they say, from when Crater Lake exploded. Over 7,000 years, and they're finding cultural artifacts below this. You know, our families will tell you that we know that they were since the very beginning when the Creator put us here. Those are our artifacts, but are they really known? Because as the Washoe people believe, those are things that went with the past, and you carry things in the forward and the future. So that's important that, you know, we know that. How can native waters and arid land support or facilitate these exchanges? You know, we run a cattle ranch, as I explained to you earlier. We irrigate alfalfa, we grow different crops. Climate change has definitely impacted the tribe. This area has been in a severe drought. 5, 6, 7 years, there were years when some of the portions of the Carson River would run completely dry. Some of the things that you talked about, you've heard, you know, on the local news, I hear, well, this has been a record year for water, and we're going to start building more. We're going to expand, we're going to build homes in all these outlying valleys, we're going to do all these different things. 1 year of decent precipitation or moisture has seemed to make people forget, you know, 6 or 7 years of quality of life, not only for us, but livestock as well as wildlife. Priority to me and my family is the wildlife. It's relation to how we live. You know, the cattle may come and go, but what is occupied as long as our people, those are the things that are valuable and important to our families and to our people. Commercialization of hunting and gathering practices, those are negatively impacting our families. Devastation of wildfire and ecological practices have destroyed countless thousands of acres of wildfire or wildland where our families would traditionally gather and hunt. That's not going to come back in my children or children's generation. 100 years is what it's taken, more or less, for the Comstock to try to revitalize the land, and still, it's never going to be what it once was. How do you tie that all into something that's positive, like I said, in my opinion, is to promote your youth into education, you promote your families into health and well-being, to living and living within their means and respecting their resources across the board. And it's one of those things, you know, like I said at the beginning, I would just like to thank the panel for the opportunity to speak. I can ramble on forever, but I'm not going to talk anymore after this, but thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you. I'd like to give it over to Kalani.
Thanks so much, you guys. Sorry about that volume thing. At the time, you should travel alone. On a little far, you should take everyone with you. So I'm going to apologize because we're going to go fast on account of time and what we want to share with you. First of all, I want to acknowledge everybody for being there. Thank you so much. I believe the doctrine of relationship, the doctrine of recognition, the doctrine of protocol should replace the doctrine of discovery that the papal bulls are built on in 1490. I don't know why we listen to land court decisions that are based on an erroneous document. In that regard, I want to make sure that my eyes do not deceive me. And is that Chris Caldwell sitting in the circle?
Yes.
Brother, good to see you, man. And you bring in our good Cola Bob Goff to mind, and that's always a good thing, you know, so, wow, thank you. This project I'm about to show you, I'm just going to show you excerpts of and jump back in. It's the newest project worked on by Intertribal Coup and Olohana Foundation and the work we're doing with the Indigenous Phonology Network. Watch, and then I'll interrupt.
Because the production of food that is grown here is almost entirely dependent upon imported fuel, imported fertilizer, imported chemicals. We are highly dependent upon a global distribution system that brings us our food and the means to grow food from faraway places. We are on tenuous life support, and climate change raises the stakes. This extreme dependency does not become obvious until an event strikes that interrupts the flow of goods in the global supply chain. We know such events are both natural and man-made.
Here's one of the plants from our yard. Wow, so beautiful. And the avocados, and the collard greens over here. They all come from the yard. Some ginger and a lemon that we're gonna use later. And this, you gotta look at this. This is a air yam, Dioscorea. Yeah. It's really cool. It's kind of like a potato.
Here's our little papaya tree. And I just wanted to show it to you because in this garden, there are so many different kinds of plants and they're all growing really close together in this 10 by 25 plot.
So you can see, we're working in this 10 by 25 plot size. The idea was to return a classroom to a home. I want to echo what I've been hearing everybody else talk about, which is the relational component back to the environment, sorely lacking in our education system and the experience that we have. I myself was raised traditionally by my grandparents, so I don't have quite the same educational experience others have, and my focus is a little bit more attuned to that. I want to tell you that we're working with indigenous elders throughout the Pacific, Samoa, Tonga, Palau, Fiji, Micronesia. Why we think this is relevant? Pacific Islands are just like Native American reservations. Our jurisdiction and capacity ends right at the shore. If something doesn't wash up, we don't have it. Our economic and political jurisdictions end just like a reservation boundary. You either got it there or you don't got it. So living sustainably, living resiliently is very important. This is a quote from one of my elders. Resilient communities are ones that learn from the past, design the lessons into the present, and pass them on to the future. My grandfather said to me a while ago, he said, the past should always have a voice in everything you do. The past should never have a vote. So the past should never control the decisions we're making forward, but the past should always inform us. And we use indigenous knowledge and our practices to create this capacity in community. And I want to remind us that this is a conversation about values, how the values in our indigenous cultures reinforce our societal capacities. I want to say this. I believe the values are only worth what we see in explicit behavior. Can the value be seen in the behavior demonstrated by the people of the village, the clan, or the community? If it cannot, then it's more like rules for common ground. It belongs on a piece of paper in a filing cabinet. It's really not worth anything. So, how do we determine these values? I've heard historic trauma conversations. I've been hearing people regard natural learning systems, eco-service learning, social justice. All these things are part of the equations that pepper us. Our tack is we are taking emergency management as our trigger key. No one wants to talk about climate change. Everybody wants to talk about the weather. So we're going to address this from extreme weather events.
These islands. And like the fingers, he says, the most important people on this earth would be the fisherman, the farmer, the hunter, the gatherer, and the medicine man. Because look at the lima, all these fingers work together. If you put the lima down this way, you can always dig on the hole, come in your seed, home up, you pull off the crop. Only time you turn your head this way is to give you that. With that in mind, we're just waiting for a great moon to come. And it's very important, I believe, that we give our people, not just the white people, but the people of Hawaii, bear shaking, having some type of self-sustenance in their yards, in their communities. And if you define more community, you know what it's all about. It's a community association. But to be able to have a plot of land where you can depend upon yourself to grow this thing, so that when the great food comes, at least we'll be prepared in a short sense and have the ability to depend upon each other. Because I may have this crop here, my neighbor may have another one. And if we look at like the types of aqua from before, that's what it did. They all depended upon each other. What it is? Who's sovereignty for our people? Grow what the area of the land accepts. Now we're forced on this road. I think that's crucial. Obviously, it's going to food. Obviously, it's going to food lab. You know, it comes out of this aina that which feeds us. So those who have the opportunity to grow, there is a no-brainer. It's a no-brainer situation. So hopefully, politicians, if you're out there listening, give us a chance to be self-sustainable. And it takes the pressure off you. When the great way comes, when the great way comes, you're responsible for all people. That's some of our people. You're responsible for yourselves. At least to get ourselves off the ground, be self-sustainable. At that time.
So as you can see, this is part of the program. We have our message with Region 9, Oakland. We have 1.2 million people living in a 60-mile island that experiences Category 4 and 5 hurricanes. One has not made landfall for 23 years. That means we're way overdue. They only have 14 hours of food supply. What do you think is going to happen on day 3 after the hurricane? What we see right now in Puerto Rico. So we're working hard to create food capacity by using indigenous methodologies around food forestry, not two-dimensional gardening, four-dimensional food forests. We've discovered, well, as a Hawaiian, we always do this, but we're now teaching the university to discover the value of these things. And suddenly, I go from an archaic anomaly teaching on campus to the center of all these conversations. I'm going to try and lay this out for you in the best way I know how. Carletta and I have been thinking and talking about all kinds of things for half a decade now, you know, trying to suss out some thinking. The value sets, I believe, stack up like this. I have three explicit values that I want to see as behavior shared to me by my grandparents. The first admonition is, are the children fed? To feed children requires an awful lot of infrastructure. First of all, you're suggesting that there are children. That means people are coupling. That means relationships are occurring. That means there's some kind of social structure. That means there's infrastructure and shelter. Have you ever tried to feed a one-year-old? It takes all your attention. You literally got to stop and do it. You can't be doing anything else. So feeding children requires great capacity on the part of young mothers, which, by the way, want to make changes in society. That's what we should reinforce, young mothers. I digress, though. Second admonition, are the elderly comfortable? I'm not talking about surviving and getting by. Are the elderly comfortable? Does your village, can your clan account for diminishing capacity? Do you understand that you're going to have to provide this additional benefit? And so your resource management, your living environment, all has to accommodate the idea of elders. Want to know why we don't have elders? Because we kill them off and send their senior citizens home. So, are the elderly comfortable? That's the second value set admonition. The third one, which I think is the most critical and foundational to the survival of our clans, our tribes back home, are the women unafraid? Are the women unafraid? If the women are unafraid, they will see to the first two admonitions. If the women are afraid, I think the men in your clan ought to start asking themselves some deep questions. Why? These are the three value sets left to me by my grandfather. This is what I teach our children, our grandchildren. This is where we go. We answer those three simple questions. Are the children fed? Are the old people comfortable? Are the women unafraid? We can answer that in the affirmative. Our clan is doing okay. We're getting by. We're gonna adapt. We're gonna to survive this climate change. That's our intention. My friend Bob Goff said, climate change is inevitable. Adaptation is optional. In this session, Carlotta, I can tell you we meet on the first Tuesday. We're planning on expanding our work. We're going to do a science intake project. Our belief is our research since 1959 has been fudged by every little research center slowly trying to get the next round of funding. If we want to get good prediction models, we got to stop. Take genuine snapshots of what we see going on. This means no longer letting the research question drive the research, but rather we observe in totality, deliver the observations to the science community, let them extrapolate what they need to, and then redesign these projection models built on reality, not on funding streams.
Thank you,
Kalani.
Thank you so much.
I'm dropping the mic, and I'm walking off.
thank you so much to the panelists and to Kalani joining us remotely. I've known Kalani for quite some time. It's great that he's able to join us virtually. And he did mention one of our friends, Bosco, that we lost recently, and we just want to honor his memory and we had on Native communities in terms of environment and climate change. So I want to open up this to a discussion. We had some really great points about what is resiliency and framing it in terms of a relationship, doctrinal relationship, and being a steward, not responding, but putting it back to the family unit, the clan, thinking about healthy families, going back to language and sharing, valuing Native science as opposed to Western management that includes interdisciplinary work that's inclusive, where traditional ecological knowledge is implemented as opposed to just tribal consultation where the listening only goes so far. How do we find balance with the environment where we're part of that balance, not that we're separate from that? So want to open up to the others in terms of what do people think about traditional values and implementing it? What do people think about what the panel has shared? And how is it possible to share that across other communities?
Again, Alvita Martinez from Walker River. I think that it's, I really enjoyed everybody's talk here. And again, I'm from Walker River Fire Tribe, so again, we grow alfalfa, but the gathering has been pinus and buckberries. But fortunately, we've been able to hire college interns for the last 6 years for our tribe, and every year they've kind of taken it upon themselves to do what they call traditional ecological knowledge project. And they've these college kids have been just learning taught to do things. I mean, they went out and picked buckberries, and they rounded up a whole bunch of other kids, little kids and high school kids, and went and did the whole process of picking, cleaning, and took a couple of elders, one again actually to teach them how to do it and pray, and then actually another one to help them process it and make jam and jelly and give it out. So they learned a whole bunch of stuff, like just in a short period of time, but they learned gathering, they learned how to make food, they learned how to find it, they learned how to pull each other in, they taught all these little kids, and that's something that they know now forever. I don't know how to do that. I never learned how to do that. They know how to do it. a bunch of them know how to do it. So, but again, it was like these college kids, who the younger kids respected, you know, because I don't think I could load up those kids and they wouldn't. But these young people are just really want to learn, you know. And, but then they, that was 1 year, then the next year, then they videoed it and made it into a presentation, you know, and shared this at the Native American Fish and Wildlife Society, and then gave out jelly to some of the people that prayed. So, but for them to share their knowledge, they, to me, these young people were just kids to me. It's like, you gotta teach them young. I mean, I'm like this guy here, we grew up in the 50s, so, hate to say it, back in the 50s, we already did all of this, what everybody's trying to learn now. We already had cattle, pigs, we all grew gardens, we all had to work in the field, we all had to do all of that. We all did that. We were survivors from when we were kids. I raised dang rabbits, you know? But, so we did that already, so the Indian people are the survivors. We always are because we do have that knowledge. And we do know where to go find the things, like the pine nuts and the berries, and no matter what, because you went and did it. And this year, though, one of my college kids had never been pine picking. We're like, what the hell? Where are you living at? You know, he's living in Arrington, of all places. First time in his life picking pine nuts. You know, doing the whole cleaning and never ate pine nuts in his life. We're like, you know, you're 19 years old. But now he did it. Now he knows how to make that thing, buckberry jam, and he knows how to pick pine nuts, you know, all in a matter of a couple of months. But these kids are sponges for knowledge. You gotta get them kids involved. So like, I'm glad, like I said, I'm glad to see you young people, like Helen, you know, look what she's done. She's learning her language, you know, she's a leader. But I just see that what they call the Western science and the traditional science has to go together. And I think that's what a lot of us older people see. You know, you guys in the college, you folks still going to college, you know, you see it. But I just think it's great that everybody, the Native people are the ones that are taking the lead now. And how are you gonna do it, sustain your family just like that? Little piece of land, you're gonna grow enough food to sustain your family. That's just the way it is, and that's resilience. As climate change is real, it's like Washington Chairman said, we've been in a drought for it's like 6 years. Our temperatures are over 100 degrees, you know, for like a whole 2 months there. You know, that's not normal. Mm-hmm. Not, I mean, it's changing. It's changing. You know, we have to be able to survive. But I'm not worried about it. I think people are going to be the last ones standing anyway.
So, what are communities open? Is there opportunities for cross-cultural exchange? And I think you, Kurt, talked about the ways that you shared across the lifeways of corn from Canada to southern Mexico. What do others think about this type of cross-cultural exchange, and how can that be done? Any thoughts?
I have a thought. I think that's awesome that you're doing that. I enjoy everybody talking about it. And as all of you were talking, see these red circles here? That's what you're doing. That's what we're doing, sharing, coming together. And I always wonder why all Native tribes can't come together to be strong. It can happen, you know? Although I don't see it happening at home with our four tribes, Hill River, Donatham, Akchin, and Salt River, we share the same issues, but we have a tendency to have our own differences, you know? But I'm a person, I'm one of your 50s too, and you are right. Been there, we knew. We knew better than to open our mouths. We knew better. But I asked our farm board at the time when I was on the farm board, How come we don't grow West Banco? Is that Lloyd's ever come to work with the other girl didn't get in trouble? But you know, the answer I got was, it cost too much. And during that time, we were talking about, or the Head Start programs in our community were wanting to rebuild. They had cattle today, not very many. I know the TO people still have cattle, and the TO people carry more of their traditions and cultures than we do because we're surrounded by cities. And I'll say it, and it doesn't matter who hears me, we are spoiled. Last year, we built 450 homes for our people. Were they appreciative? Yeah, maybe some, you know, but not. We still want more. We have programs for our people to help our people. Heat and energy programs for the elders. It's good, but I'm just gonna say at the beginning, we build our own welfare system. You know, and I just feel really strong that in our leadership, I'm glad that you talk strongly.